Now we no longer know him in this way. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away, and look, new things have come. Now listen, everything is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us, as you and me, the body of Christ, he gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, as he has committed the message of reconciliation to us. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. What's an ambassador? An ambassador is an official acting as a representative of a nation who is sent to a foreign country to represent the official position of the sovereign body that gave him the authority. So the United States of America has ambassadors that go all over the world. An ambassador to Israel, an ambassador to Russia, an ambassador to Chile. What do these ambassadors do? They represent America in those countries. So literally speaking, they take the American way of life to those countries as our representatives. And the Bible says here that we are ambassadors of Christ. What does that mean? That means that we, as citizens of heaven, have been sent out into a foreign land to now be representatives of heaven on earth. And what are we to do? What is our official position? Be reconciled to God. That is our official position. We go out, we preach the gospel, the good news to the ungodly, in the hopes that they might be reconciled to God. We invite them to share in the most amazing relationship a person can have. Go on and read with me now. For Christ, certain that God is appealing through us, we plead on Christ's behalf. Be reconciled to God. He made the one who did not know sin to be sin for us so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Let me just remind you tonight who the gospel is for. Go back to Ephesians chapter number 6. There's one little verse. Continue to jump off the page at me. And I had to find a way to share it. And it's at the end of the section of slaves and masters. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 9. And masters, treat your slaves the same way without threatening them. Now listen, because you know that both their master and yours is in heaven. And listen to this, and there is no favoritism with God. What does this verse teach us? This verse teaches us that no matter how rich, no matter how poor, no matter how tall, no matter how short, no matter how handsome, no matter how unattractive, no matter how old, or no matter how young, no matter how clean or dirty, innocent or defiled a person may be, they are never too far out of the reach of the loving arms of God. Amen. God can reach down and drastically change their life forever. The gospel is the gospel for the ungodly.
That's right.
Remember Jesus? The Bible say about Jesus? Who did he hang out with? Tax collectors and sinners. Where do we find Jesus? We find him amongst the ungodly.
Yeah.
We find him touching the leper. We find him casting demons out of raging demoniacs. We find him opening the eyes of the blind. We find him stopping the flow of blood from a woman's body. We find him raising the dead. We even find him on the cross of Calvary, guaranteeing paradise to a thief who was being crucified. The gospel is the gospel for the ungodly. Friends, never in your religious zeal ever forget where you come from.
Amen.
We have this propensity in our church body to put on our fancy coats and ties and just to forget who we were before salvation. Can I tell you, friends, I wasn't always yellow jacket and red slacks. It was just 7 years ago that I was a homeless drug addict living in a van. Strung out on every drug you could imagine, abusive to my wife, abusive to my children, stealing from my mama and daddy, breaking into homes and pawning things off in pawn shops. Hater of God, hater of the church. I promise you, you would not have liked me very much. But I'll never forget the day I woke up in Rock Hill, South Carolina. My daddy had given me a little green Bible to read. And I woke up living in my van, and there was that Bible. It was covered in vomit from a night of partying before. And I thought to myself, I've done too much. I've gone too far. I've got to go to church. And I went out and I got in that old rickety van and I drove to Rollison Road Baptist Church in Rock Hill, South Carolina. Got high in the parking lot. And then I walked inside. Brother Bill Pay, when I walked inside, I'll never forget what happened. Standing about 15 feet away from me, right where this brother's sitting with the navy blue shirt on, about 15 feet away from me, stood a woman named Joanne Broom, who was my third grade Sunday school teacher. And Miss Joanne Broom shouted across at me. I had not seen this woman in 10 years. She shouted at me and she said, Zach Williams, I've been praying for you. And that woman, dressed in the finest dress and fancy pearls and nice earrings, walked across that foyer and wrapped her arms around this ungodly man and broke me. She did not shun the ungodly. Instead, she invited me to share in the most amazing relationship I could ever experience. Amen. A relationship with Christ. Amen. I wasn't saved that day. I wasn't saved for about 8 more weeks. But even to this day, what she did for me is being told to you. Amen. It had that much of an impact on my life. Friends, don't shun the ungodly. Don't forget where you come from. Remember once you were just like them. I want to close tonight by giving you a quote by the great theologian A.W. Tozer. He wrote a book entitled The Radical Cross. He had a chapter entitled Integration or Repudiation. And in this chapter he wrote the following words. Society, being fluid, usually moves like the wind, going all out in one direction until the novelty wears off, or there's a war or a depression. Then the breeze sets in another way, and everyone is supposed to go along with it without asking too many questions. Though this constant change of direction should certainly cause the thoughtful soul to wonder whether anyone really knows what all the excitement about is after all. However absurd this may appear, when thus stated baldly, it is nevertheless a fair description of the most popular brand of philosophy now engaging the attention of society. So many, so efficient, are the media of mass communication that when those of the educational world decide that it is time for the wind to change, the common people quickly get the drift and swing obediently into the breeze. And anyone who resists it is a killjoy and a spoilsport, to say nothing of being old-fashioned and dogmatic. Well, if to escape the charge of being dogmatic, I must accept the changing dogmas of the masses, then I'm willing to be known as a dogmatist at no holds barred. We who call ourselves Christians are supposed to be a people apart. We claim to have repudiated the wisdom of this world and adopted the wisdom of the cross as the guide for our lives. We have thrown in our lot with that one who, while he lived on earth, was the most unadjusted of the sons of men. He would not be integrated into society. He stood above it, and he condemned it by withdrawing from it, even while dying for it. Die for it he would, but surrender to it he would not.
Amen.
Living counterculturally in our relationship. The determining factor is your relationship with God. A correct understanding of the cross will superimpose a heavenly culture on earth. We should never shun the ungodly in our attempt to live counterculturally. Instead, we should invite them into the most amazing relationship a person can have.
Amen.
This is all done through the power of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Father, I just give you the glory, Lord. I trust that what you wanted to be said has been said. I trust that these words will sink into the hearts of the hearer. God, I realize that I've probably talked way too long. And I realize that, Father, many people probably picked up little seeds here and there, but I pray as they go home and think about all that was said, not only tonight, but every night this week, I pray, God, that their lives would begin to reflect the glory found in your word. In all reality, God, we do need to live counterculturally. We do that by being citizens of heaven, bringing heaven's culture to earth. Father, I pray, I sincerely pray that Canton, North Carolina may see heaven's culture lived out to the body of Christ at West Canton. May everyone know there's something different about these people. We give you the glory, O God. In your name I pray. Amen. John.